Hey guys, so I'm here in Oahu and I'm visiting with the Arnsteins. So I thought that this would be a good time to sit down with Michael and talk to him about his new life in Hawaii and some of the changes he's been going through out here, and also talk about, you know, what's been going on with the community and the Woodstock Fruit Festival. So Michael, I've got some questions for you.
All right, let's hear them.
So let's get into them. You seem to have kind of fallen out of the public eye for a little bit. You haven't been making as many videos and it seems like you're not really running as much. So I'm curious what's been going on with you for like the past year.
Well, for many years, as most people know, I spent a lot of time running, lots and lots of running. And I reached pretty much all the goals that I wanted to in running. I ran out of races and times that I wanted to reach. And I thought I made a pretty big impact on promoting, you know, the fruitarian diet, and I wanted to do something for myself and for my family, and spend more time with my wife in a better environment. So I'm not running that much.
Okay.
Doing other things. I still run, but I don't think I run more than maybe 30, maybe 40 miles a week.
And so much.
Which I know maybe that sounds like a lot for some
a
people,
lot.
But. Yeah, I try to run, you know, I enjoy running, so I do it regardless of whether I'm competing, and I try to run like once a week for maybe 20 mile run, just because that feels good, and then, you know, maybe three or four other days of the week I'll run, you know, at anywhere from 5 to 10 miles, and I'm doing other things. I'm spending a lot of time in the water here.
Yeah.
There's so many things to do in Hawaii, and I've just been doing what I set out to do when I came here. I wanted to spend more time with my kids. Mm-hmm. And my wife, and I'm doing that, and I'm very happy. So I'm sorry I haven't made any videos. And I'm 37. When I turn 40, I plan on going back into running and to competing, because I want to see what I can do, maybe try to beat some of my times and show people that after 10 years on this diet that I could improve.
Right.
But for the next couple years, I'm going to keep having a little bit too much sun exposure.
That's awesome. Well, it sounds like you've been up to some good stuff.
Yeah.
So what's it been like transitioning from living on the island of Manhattan to now the island of Oahu? That's like a huge change for you.
Yeah, it is a huge change. Living in New York for 16 years and then prior to that, I grew up right outside of the city of New Jersey. I feel like I've been a New Yorker for 36 years. So coming out here was like, I mean, it was almost like moving to Mars.
Yeah, it's a totally different planet.
Totally
really.
Different, totally yeah. Different. And it's a trip. A lot of times I wake up in the morning and I'm like, I just don't realize where, you know, my life's made this huge left turn.
Yeah.
It's surreal. And it was really difficult. But I really enjoy challenges. Whether it's, you know, seeing how far I can run or, mm-hmm. If I can stick to a diet that where my health comes first, or whether it's, you know, run a business or have three kids. I like challenges. So moving here was a big challenge, but I'm embracing it and I love it.
And how does the traffic here compare to the traffic in New York?
The traffic in Oahu, so I hear it's really bad, but I mainly work on the internet, so I don't see much of it. So I'm pretty fortunate.
Okay,
yeah.
Lucky you.
Yeah.
All right, so do you have any regrets? Do you miss anything from the New York life? And do you think you're gonna be living here long term?
I think I don't have any regrets. I'm really happy with the decision. It was a really difficult experience to try to, you know, sell everything we owned and literally come here with a bunch of suitcases.
Because you guys have lived in that area like almost your
yeah.
whole lives.
Yeah, so leaving all the friends behind, the family, just not being physically in my office with all the people that I work with.
Yeah.
It's like, it was difficult. But I don't have any regrets. So far, so good. It's been really... It's been great.
So let's talk about the Woodstock Fruit Festival. For those of you who don't know, Mike started the Woodstock Fruit Festival in 2011, and now it's grown into an event that is having 2-week sessions, and it's just an awesome thing. So I think the big question that people really want to know about is, you know, what are your thoughts on what happened with Harley and Freelee? And, you know, can you give us a little bit of an overview of what happened this past year and how this happened?
I think before I talk about the actual events of Harley and Freelee not being part of the festival anymore, I think it's important to for me to explain how I see it from the perspective of Harley specifically, because I know a lot more about Harley than I do know about Freelee. Mm-hmm. And I've always felt like I can identify with Harley on a very deep level.
Right.
And the people that don't know what happened between the Fruit Festival and Harley and Freelee aren't going to really understand what I'm talking about unless they've been up on the gossip scene. So if you want to learn more about it, just go to Harley and Freelee's channel and you'll see lots of videos about the Woodstock Fruit Festival. So going back to how I identify and relate to Harley, I think Harley had a similar upbringing and experience that I did when I was a kid. He was, he grew up, he had a hard childhood.
Yeah.
And I felt like he felt alone and not really understood. I felt like he was pretty angry. Mm-hmm. And I identify with that in a lot of ways. When I was a teenager, I was doing lots of drugs. I was a bad kid. Mm-hmm. But I was very fortunate. I was very lucky. My mother threw me out of the house, which I think also happened to Harley. And I went to a residential rehab for 2 months. And right when I was 16, I started going to Alcoholics Anonymous meetings. And for people that know what AA is about, it's a group environment where I would go to mostly men's meetings, mostly guys were there, and most of the guys were considerably older than me. They were in their 20s and 30s, and they were trying to piece their life back together, and I was trying to piece my life together at the same time. And these people really helped me kind of face my demons, and it allowed me to mature in a tremendous way, and that's how I eventually got into health. I became a vegetarian and then eventually vegan because I really did a lot of self-exploration and perspective of what was my life supposed to be about and what was important to me.
Mm-hmm.
So I went from being really destructive to trying to be really positive. And I see the same thing from what I know about Harley, kind of same thing happened to him. But like Harley, I still carry some of that distrust in people.
Right.
And that I had a tough time, and that at the end of the day, I gotta rely on myself.
Yeah.
And you can't really trust people completely. You got to have your guard up. And I somebody told me about a comment that Harley left on some video, and I identified with it a lot. He's in this comment that he left. He wrote about how when he was a teenager, he was sleeping outside in the middle of a field, and he was shivering, and it was cold, and it was at night. And he had this moment of clarity where he said, "Harley, you just got to harden the fuck up." He said, you know, like he just had this realization that it's like, I'm not putting my reliance on anybody anymore. And I kind of feel like, you know, he took on a perspective that was safer, but it also keeps him away from being able to have relationships on a really, I think in a healthy or meaningful way.
Like it's his way or the highway.
Yeah, and it's safer that way because at the end of the day, you know, if you've got to only rely on yourself, you know, you're going to be okay. But it doesn't work out too well when you're trying to work in a group environment or within a community. Mm-hmm. And so Harley for me was somebody that I could identify with. And when I saw his videos in 2008, when I first read 80-10-10, Dr. Doug's book, the book like turned me overnight. I went hardcore, all, you know, fruits and vegetables, raw, low fat.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved it.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, with most diets, you try something and you can maybe drift away from it. But when I saw Harley's videos, he was the first guy on YouTube who was talking about, I'm eating raw fruits and vegetables and I'm making it happen. Mm-hmm. I'm making it happen because my health is a number one priority and I want to help the animals and I want to help the environment. And that's what's important to me. And I was like, yeah, man, I like what I'm hearing. You know, there's more in this than me just wanting to run faster. This is about living a truth that talks to my core. Mm-hmm. So I watched these videos of Harley talking about, you know, living in Thailand, doing whatever he needs to do to get the food and stay raw because that was his priority.
Right.
So I started doing the same thing. It was so much inspiration, and if you can, I'd like you to put in a clip in this interview of one of his old videos so people can see kind of the Harley that I fell in love with, and the Harley that gave me inspiration, that drove almost my idea to start the Woodstock Fruit Festival. Mm-hmm. Because the only thing missing for me in this diet and lifestyle was more community.
Right.
Felt very isolated. And I saw Harley kind of felt that way too. And I think that's why he really started 30 Bananas a Day.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And that was a huge thing for me, being part of 30 Bananas a Day. And, you know, we all kind of just started up this community together. So you'll let's roll that clip, and you'll see what I'm talking about in terms of Harley's videos from when he was starting out in this lifestyle and the stuff that he's doing now, which I think is the Harley that was in the field freezing saying, harden the fuck up.
How to be a raw vegan. This is my car. And this is my little trailer. Full of mangoes, 35 cents each from the local farmer. Jackfruit, forage that. You know, that many mangoes will last me, they're about 100 calories each. You know, I'm doing about 3,500 to 4,000 calories a day because I'm an athlete. And I'm doing the miles because I have to. I don't have a car, so I must use my body. If I want to eat, I've got to move. So that's, 35 cents each. You know, people go, but that's cool, Harley, because you live in the tropics. You know, you live, you know, where all the fruit is. And it's like, well, if I go to the local supermarket here, mangoes cost $4.50 to $5 each, and they're not even wild or organic. So I don't panic, man. I'll go straight farmer direct or to the local markets and get in touch, you know, with who's selling the produce, get in touch with who's growing your food, man. Because raw food's about getting it from the tree, getting it from the vine, feeling the vine. It's not ordering food online. You know, like, food's got to come from Mother Nature's laws, not from some factory jaws making some superfood from some super dude, you know, telling you're going to be some, you know, just... I'm not going to go into that because I don't want to be dissing people in the raw food crew too much, you know. All I'm saying, man, is fruits and shoots, i.e. celery, lettuce, purslane, tender greens like that, are going to digest a lot better than kale and broccoli. So the easier your food digests, the more energy and stamina you will have, because the number one common transit food is fresh fruit. Number two is tender greens. So if you're eating things like nuts and powders and gourmet stuff and oil, man, that's not food, that's refined fat. There is no oil in nature. So if you're eating oil, don't expect to get raw vegan vitality results, man, because that ain't what the diet's about. It ain't about refined sugar like agave. It ain't about stealing food from the bees and eating their bee spit mixed with pollen, aka honey. It's about eating sufficient calories from fruit, so you're not having to reach for these refined sugars like agave, yacon, maple, honey, all that stuff. You know, it's a very simple diet. Anyone can do it. If you're a street kid in Bangladesh, if you're, you know, a broker in New York, if you're an actress in LA, if you're an Olympic cyclist in Adelaide, you can do it, man, because it's nature's design. It's not some eat right for your blood type hype book written by some fraud trying to make some cash on vulnerable people who aren't prepared to take responsibility for their actions, and they're relying on some book to justify their poor eating habits. You know, your lifestyle's got to change, your identity's got to change. You've got to identify yourself as a healthy person who has an active lifestyle, and then you'll make lasting changes, or you'll forever be chasing your tail behind some pill gimmick, cleanse, fad, crap, and just chasing your tail, sacrificing your wealth and burning your health, and getting to the end of the line going, oh my god, you know, Mother Nature had it right all along. You know, if you want natural results, you gotta do what Mother Nature says, man. You know, Mother's always right. You go against Mum, man, you're not gonna get what, you know, you should be getting. So don't be saying, I tried that raw vegan thing, it didn't work for me, because A, you didn't eat enough fruit, man. You starved yourself. You're on a starvation phase one diet. You know, phase one starvation craziness. You're doing things like cacao and that, man. That's like a toxic drug, man. That ain't health forming. That's transitional food, man. Eat it for a month and then get over it, you know, get over your raw pizza, get over all this gourmet stuff, man, you don't need it. You know, you can't find a flax cracker in nature. You can't find fat year-round in nature. So, you know, keep it simple. Don't be saying you tried more vegan until you've done 8-1-1 and you've done it right. You do it for at least a year, man. Get your 12 hours sleep. Simplify your lifestyle. Get the water. Get the emotional poise. Learn how to control your state. And you will thrive. Like all us zealot 8-1-1 fuckers out there ranting and raving on all those forums and all those lecture series, man. We're out there. We're passionate. We want to help you. You know, we're not doing it for the money, man. We're doing it for the love. We're doing it because we know Mother Nature never broke the heart that loved it. All right. Peace.
Harley is like aggressive now. He's hardened the fuck up, you know? And I don't want to go back to that because I used to be that way too. And I'm trying to have better relationships with my wife or my kids or even Harley, you know? Like, I don't want to hate Harley. I don't want to be resentful at Harley. I want to be able to, like, you know, communicate. Yeah. I don't want to get cold and hard. Mm-hmm. So I understand where he's coming from. And at the end of the day, it's a tragedy that what's happened.
Absolutely, yeah.
And, but then to go back to the actual story of the events that got us to where we are now, after the 2013 festival, Harley, was making lots of videos that were, I heard about them, but I didn't see them. I couldn't believe it. They're like, yeah, he poured like a pound of sugar into his smoothie. And I'm like, nah, what are you talking about? And they're like, yeah, and he ate 4 pizzas. And I was like, I saw that video and I was like,
what?
I'm like, I don't get it, man. And then I started sending him emails and I'm like, what are you doing, man? I'm like, is this like, well, okay, you know, I get it, you know, the more views, it makes sense, like, we got to bring in more people, like,
yeah.
I see your angle, but, like, 4 pizzas, like,
I thought pizza was, like, part of the problem, and now it's part of the solution.
Yeah,
like,
you know, so I asked him about it, and I saw, you know, where he was coming from and why he was doing this. Harley's main impetus and goal is to try to get people on a diet that's better for the animals and I think for the environment. And if you ran, or I ran 30bananasaday.com, I think we would be overwhelmed with the turnover. People come into this lifestyle, like, I mean, just it's a revolving door.
Yeah.
And I got a regular job, and other people probably have no idea how much time Harley and Freelee spent talking and coaching these people. Mm-hmm. And day after day after day, full-time job, they're talking to these people, and they're just, people are just constantly just going out, coming and going out. And they're like, okay, why are they coming in? Why are they going out? Well, we're bringing them in because we're trying to get them off animal foods.
Right.
And they're leaving because they don't feel satisfied just eating fruits and vegetables. Mm-hmm. So it's like, okay, I guess we got to bend the rules if we really want to try to reach the masses. Mm-hmm. So what are we going to do? Well, first we're going to tell people, if you have some cooked food, don't stress about it as long as it's vegan. Mm-hmm. So they probably were telling people that all the time, but it's like, you know, they've got a huge fan base. If people just hear them say that but don't see them doing it, they're going to be like, oh, you know, I'm like,
we don't know how to do it.
Yeah, we don't know how to do it. Or like, you know, you're still better than us because you're not doing it.
Right.
So we're second class citizens. So I get it. And I can respect where he's coming from in getting on camera and having the guts to be like hardcore all raw to eating 4 pizzas. That took some serious balls. I mean,
it's a total identity change.
Yeah, I mean, the guy is fearless. Mm-hmm. You know, he didn't care what other people were gonna think. He's like, I'm trying to get these people to be on a sustainable vegan diet.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I respect that.
Yeah.
Like, I get it. And I don't think what he was doing was wrong. I think he's a pioneer in his own way. But when I started getting emails like crazy from people sending me these videos and these links, and I'm like, holy shit, are we gonna have a backup plan at the Woodstock Fruit Festival for the people that don't want to eat fruit? Are we gonna have potatoes and rice at night?
We're gonna have the pizza line.
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, like, is, you know, like, is that gonna be? And I'm like, you know, and then he's going after people that are also part of the community, and he's being confrontational. And I was like, Harley, come on, man. I'm like, don't go after other people and start turning this into some kind of food fight. You know, you do the pizza video, pour the sugar on your smoothie, fine. But, like, take it easy, man. Like, the fruit festival and the community is about raw foods. And you can say fruit's the best, but if you're eating all this stuff all the time, it's not a backup plan.
Right.
Monkey see, monkey do, man. And how the hell did you wake up the next morning after you ate four pizzas? There's no way.
I couldn't do it.
There's no way you wake up feeling like, yeah, carb up, man. I feel great. Come on. I came to this diet after I was eating all the low-fat, vegan, cooked foods. And I gave up on that because it wasn't working, because I didn't feel good. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel as bad as the people eating McDonald's, but I didn't feel great. Mm-hmm. I feel great. I feel fantastic eating fruits and vegetables, low-fat, high water content.
I can testify to that. He's the Energizer Bunny.
Yeah, so, and I mean, all those crazy running events and things that I pulled off, I was not... There's no chance I would be able to do that stuff and stay injury-free if I was eating pizza and rice.
Mm-hmm.
No way. So, I called Harley on the phone. I emailed him, and I'm like, let's talk every night about this because we got a problem. I really think you want to go after a bigger audience, but
He's isolating himself.
Yeah, you're isolating yourself, and it's like, you know what, man? If you want to go middle of the road... I get it, but I don't think, you know, what we're trying to create together in this community, we're trying to create a new direction. And I think long term, you're cutting yourself off and you're limiting, you know, the real potential of what we're trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
So we didn't agree. He didn't agree with me about that, and I respect him. You know, he felt like people can't get fruit. It's too expensive. Mm-hmm. And he's right. High quality fruit, I'm a fruit snob. I can't eat dates and bananas.
Yeah.
I mean, I can blend the dates. I can put a little cinnamon in it. I can freeze the bananas.
But you can only eat that so many
times. Yeah, but you know what? Eventually, I want diversity. And it is expensive. I go to the wholesaler. It's a pain in the neck. It's a real effort. You got to make the effort. It's not easy. Our culture is not set up for these foods to be affordable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of people, I think that I'm like just some guy who doesn't understand hardship. And, you know, it's easy for me to eat this way because I've got money or something like that.
Right.
And, you know, he can shop at Whole Foods and it's easy for him to do. Well, you know what? I think there's two different types of mentality. There's people that have the glass is half empty and the glass is half full.
Mm-hmm.
And even when I was starting out in this world and I started my own business in 1999 and I made it everything that it is today by myself with no loans or support from anybody. I remember going into what was Wild Oats at the time, which is like the Whole Foods mm-hmm. type of supermarket. And I remember walking in there and having to buy the burrito for $2.99 that went in the microwave instead of going after, you know, the fancy fruits and vegetables, which I really wanted to buy.
Right.
And I know what it felt to feel poor mm-hmm. in those times. And what I didn't do was make excuses and just say, I'm just gonna have the burrito. I said, I want the heirloom tomatoes.
Mm-hmm.
I want those fancy looking melons that I never saw before. I want the organic grapes. And damn it, I'm gonna work hard
mm-hmm.
and I'm gonna figure out how to make it happen.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I did.
Right.
And it's a blessing. It's a blessing to come from a very low place in life where you've gotta make it all on your own. Versus being born into some super, you know, rich or wealthy environment where everything's just handed to you because you can't appreciate it. And any people who feel like they're deprived or feel like they can't do this diet because they can't afford it, it's like, no. Get that out of your head. Say, what do I want in life? You know, I'm going to get it.
Right.
And when Harley was living in Thailand in 2008, he was there because he wanted to eat that way.
Right.
He made it happen.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't making excuses. He didn't say, oh, I'll have rice. It's still pretty good. It's better than what I was eating. No. He went there.
Mm-hmm.
He was durian rider. The guy who had a trailer full of durian in the back of his freaking bike.
Right.
And he was a badass. And so now we're at a crossroads. So I'm telling Harley, listen, I'm getting tons of emails. People are, this silent majority, people are not going to stand up to you openly because they know you're going to bite their head off. But we are getting inundated with emails. People are like, this, what's going on?
Right.
So I said, listen, Harley, this has been going on for months and months and months. This is going into the end of November when the festival ended in August. Okay. And he was doing this stuff even before the festival. And I kept asking him to consider changing his course of action. And I said, the Board of Governors, the other pioneers are going to meet and we're going to vote you off being a pioneer. And we want you there as a special guest, because it's unquestionable that 30 bananas a day and his following is extremely important to us. Mm-hmm. And he still always said fruit's the best. Mm-hmm. He was still, you know, he wasn't showing us fruit's the best, but he was saying it. So, and I cared about Harley, you know, I'll always be extremely grateful for what he was able to do for me. Mm-hmm. He was a very important person at one particular time for me. And no matter what happens, if he starts coming after me one day, I am always going to respect the guy in 2008 who put those videos on. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's like a bad dream. I'm so upset about it. Anyway, so I told him, Harley, let's try to, like, you know, get some moderation in the videos that you're putting out. Please stop attacking people. He wouldn't do it. So he seemed indifferent about it. Right. He, like, didn't care. He was like, all right, you want to take us off? All right, you know, he didn't want to talk on the phone. He just seemed so lackluster about it. So eventually, the board met a bunch of times. We had, you know, conference visual calls, you know, hangouts and stuff. And we're like, you know what? Let's invite Harley Freely. We'll pay for their airfare, which is like $4,000 from Australia. We give them more air travel expenses than anybody else. Mm-hmm. But you know, we got to take them off the sponsorship list, because the pioneers at the festival are about people that we're looking towards as role models. Right. They've sacrificed so much for so many years when they weren't making a dime off this stuff, and it was like they were living, you know, in a way for a very long time that spoke to themselves. These are people that inspire me, mm-hmm. and I think they inspire the rest of the community. So Harley and Freely wanted to kind of move over to getting a bigger demographic. So we still want them at the festival, just like we want other people at the festival that aren't, you know, 100%, or some of these people even eat animal foods, but we want them there because they still bring in a good community. Mm-hmm. So Harley didn't feel like it really was a big deal. So we voted, we put him on the special guest page, and then bam, everybody went freaking ballistic. And it was like, whoa, you know, hold on a second. Take it easy. You're eating pizza. You're talking about, you know, people just need to eat tons and tons of carbs, and that's the first priority, stay vegan. The fruit, if you can get it, great. If you can't, don't feel like, you know, you're a loser. But right. You know, and the fruit festival, all right, let's put all the focus on all these other people that don't live up to all these standards. Not all the pioneers eat 100% raw all the time. But as far as I know, all the pioneers want to eat raw all the time.
And promote and that promote as ideal.
As ideal, right. Yes. And they also don't go after each other with baseball bats or trying to destroy their level, their income or livelihood, or, you know, encourage other people to go after them. Mm-hmm. So it's the pioneers isn't just about, you know, who's eating 100% raw, organic, local. It's about, you know, respecting each other and identifying and promoting, like, you know, the 95% of the stuff that we all agree on. Mm-hmm. And if Don Bennett recommends for some of his clients vitamin D that's not vegan, or, you know, if Dan McDonald has some protein supplement that's, or maybe he gets some kind of commission for some whey protein that might be sold on a website, I don't see Dan on the internet saying buy whey protein. No. You know, it's like Harley's got commercials on his website. You know, he's making money off people that, you know, might go out and that might see the McDonald's commercial and might be like, holy shit, that new sandwich looks awesome. And I know I was watching Harley because I'm trying to stop eating that stuff, but that sandwich looks awesome. I'm going out and getting it. Mm-hmm. We're all, you know, there's no way for any of us not to have conflicting things going on.
Yeah, nobody's perfect.
It's just impossible. Yeah. And so Harley and Freely and their huge fan club decided that they wanted to just trash the shit out of the Fruit Festival. And that's been going on for months and months and months and months. And
it's a shame because the Fruit Festival is not about the pioneers. The Fruit Festival is about the attendees, and that's what makes it.
Yes. The Fruit Festival is awesome because of the people that are there.
Yeah.
I know that most people come to the Fruit Festival for the social atmosphere. Mm-hmm. You know, they're coming for the fruit, they're coming for the education, they're coming to see, like, you know, the YouTube stars, but they're coming to see each other.
Yeah, they need community.
They need community. And that's why I'm going there. That's why the whole freaking festival was created. Mm-hmm. And it's not my fruit festival. It's, I'm just the guy who's signing all the legal stuff where, you know, God forbid somebody, something happens, like, or the bills can't get paid. I'm the guy bailing it out. Mm-hmm. But this festival is your festival. It used to be Harley and Freelee's festival. And we need it. We need this in the community. We need one event to broadcast a message to the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. Our diet isn't crazy. Mm-hmm. We're not sick. We're not emaciated. We're healthy. We're environmentalists. We're pro animal, you know, life, and we're looking to have fun.
Mm-hmm.
It's a demonstration, and we can have a good time at the same time. And Harley and Freelee have turned this, and their fan club has turned this into like some. They say that, you know, we're like some corporate enterprise, and that you know, we have to charge a ton of money to come to our festival. It's like, are you kidding me? If you go to the Raw Till 4 festival, you're gonna have to pay to get there, you're gonna have to pay for your hotel, you're gonna pay for all your food. I mean, it's like, how do they even, it's just, it's so bizarre, it's crazy. And it's you know, they're angry, and I guess I can, from their perspective, I understand. It's like they feel betrayed, and they feel like this is bullshit. We helped you create that festival, and then you just told us to get lost as soon as we were trying to help more people.
But that isn't what actually happened.
That's not what happened. And there's no reason why we can't coexist together and be mutually supportive. I would like to go to the Raw Till 4 Festival. I would.
Yeah.
But I can't go because everybody there thinks that, like, I'm some kind of, like, elitist, like, shithead. And it's like, it's crazy. It's crazy, you know? I mean, I don't eat 100% raw all the time. Mm-hmm. But you know what? I always do want to eat 100% raw all the time.
And you just do your best.
I had a string bean the other night. Steamed string bean. It was like al dente. It looked good. I ate it. It was like this dead worm in my mouth. I don't want to eat that shit anymore. And I know it's just, if I just have a couple of them, then I'm going to dive into the cauliflower and then the zucchini and then the onions. And there's a little bit of oil from, like, when they're doing stir fry. And before you know it, I'm like, oh, this stuff tastes good. I don't want to go down that road. I've been there. And it's tough to stay away from that food. Anyway, I think what's happened is gonna blow over because the community is stronger, and we're a different market. We're trying to promote a different, you know, step, a different place in people's diet, you know, evolution. Mm-hmm. And they should respect that more. And they should call off, you know, the guns blazing, like, take out the Woodstock Fruit Festival.
Yeah, I mean, it was the best festival ever when they were there the last time, according to them.
Yes, I'm coming again next year. Yes, I will recommend the Woodstock Fruit Festival to everyone because there's nothing else on the planet like this.
Well, I absolutely loved this 7 days, last 7 days. The more, the merrier. I want 1,000 people next year. That would be great. I am coming next year for sure, definitely for 2 weeks, and I recommend everybody comes because it's just, if you want to be a high carb raw vegan, or if you just want to improve your health in some way and your appearance, then coming to this place is just the thing to do. You're going to enjoy it so much, you're going to get healthier and fitter and feel your best, so come along.
Yeah, it's a great event, and we work so hard. There's hundreds of people that make this event happen. Mm-hmm. We have 100 work exchange that do this thing.
And they work
really hard. They come to the festival, they're working 6 hours or more every single day. And without those people dedicating their heart and soul into this thing, we wouldn't have the festival. Mm-hmm. I put in, oh my God, like, my wife wants to throw me down a flight of stairs how much time I put into this festival. I'm not getting anything out of this. I just want to see other people get an experience that I know that they'll enjoy and it'll open their eyes mm-hmm. to what's possible.
Right.
Because without this diet, I wouldn't be living in Hawaii right now. Like, fruitarianism is the path to paradise. It's Anne Osborne's title of her book, and it's the truth. If you get into fruit-based diets, you will eventually leave to a better environment.
Same thing happened to me.
It's like, it's just, you can't deny it. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you right now, New York's a nice place and there's good fruit there, but
yeah, you know, can't compare.
You can't compare. You cannot compare living in a tropical environment where your food is local. So, if you can't move to Hawaii, you can move to Costa Rica. You can move to Florida. I mean, there's lots and lots of places that you can go to be in a better environment for your health.
Yeah, even Southern California, there's good stuff. Yeah.
So I think I got it all in there.
Yeah, I think.
I'm sure people are going to want to hear more things or what about this or that, but that's the main, the main gist of it.
I think that gives them a good idea of sort of what went down and, how you feel about it and everything. So do you want to dispel any of the things that are being said about, some of the pioneers? There's just been a lot of trash talk, and a lot of people that are watching, they don't know what's true and what's not, and he's the only one talking, so they don't know what to believe.
I think one of the things that I always respected about Harley is I felt like he drew the lines at some places, and he would be honest about a situation. Mm-hmm. And he said a lot of things that I think are just completely just outright lies. Mm-hmm. He's never tried to clarify anything with me. He said that the Fruit Festival paid Doug $70,000 or $50,000. Like, it's mind-boggling. Like, crazy, just ridiculous statements.
So that's obviously not true.
No way, that's crazy. When Harley and Freelee were actually paid more if you total their total compensation in terms of their flying all the way from Australia, mm-hmm. and how much they actually got from sponsors, mm-hmm. than what Doug got paid. Mm-hmm. And, people just assume that because Harley seems to be so transparent, that what he says is true.
Right.
And that he won't lie.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm extremely disappointed to say that, like, you can't trust what he's saying all the time. Mm-hmm. Yes, a lot of the times he's being honest, but he's saying things now that are completely just straight out lies. Mm-hmm. And that's dangerous.
How about the other pioneers? There's other people that have been open about eating cooked foods or processed foods. How come they haven't been demoted from being pioneers?
Well, first let me explain how the current list of pioneers even came to be. Yulia, who's the event director and who did a lot of research on lots of people in the movement when we first wanted to create the event, she came to me with a huge list of people, and we went over everybody, how long they've been promoting this publicly, mm-hmm. what their background is, how much of one thing do they eat versus another, what's their, where are they coming from, and what do we want to really focus the ethos of the event. So we invited, probably like 50 different people to become pioneers, and we said, hey, we're having this event, we can't give you any money, but we'd like you to come. And, we can let you come in for free. And, we'd like the event to be about these things. And we think that you're closely involved in that. Mm-hmm. So the people that came were basically the people that said they'll come for free. And those were our pioneers. Mm-hmm. And then they all had things in common. They all advocated generally a low-fat diet. Not all the same percentages, but generally lower fat. All raw fruits and vegetables. They'd been eating this way for a long period of time. They all promoted it publicly, and they all seemed to get along pretty well. Mm-hmm. We didn't invite anybody that seemed to have, problems with the other people that we were inviting.
Right.
So that was the first year. Then after that, we created a board of governors, and we came to the decision that anybody else who was going to be brought on as a pioneer would all have to be offered the same benefits. So they have to get comp entry, they have to be given travel expenses, and of course they have to meet the other criteria that was established based on what they ate and that they were involved in, publicly promoting this stuff. Mm-hmm. And that any new pioneer would have to be voted on by the existing pioneers. Mm-hmm. So the reason why we might not have somebody who fits all the criteria as part of the event now, it's not because they might not be a pioneer. It's because the festival has financial limitations on how many people we can comp, right. How many people we can pay travel expenses to. So just because somebody might not be a pioneer, it's
doesn't mean you don't value them.
Yeah, it doesn't mean that we don't value them. It's just like, hey, this is what we got. These people that are on the pioneers came to the first one, mm-hmm. they came to the second one, mm-hmm. they came, they stayed committed, mm-hmm. and they were in it for the goal of promoting what we're looking to do with the festivals. So, some of the pioneers at different times have not always stayed true to those. Those things.
Super ideal.
Yeah. And I'm one of those people. I mean, I've admitted to having sushi before in the past. And, you know, I just said a minute ago, like, I sometimes, if, you know, if I'm flying on an overnight, like, 20-hour flight to the Far East or something, I've had airplane food, and I'm not happy about it. I don't advocate it. I try to never put myself in that position because I just don't want to eat that stuff. And if anybody's going to get thrown off being a pioneer, it's going to be done in a group vote. 75% of the pioneers have to vote somebody on or off at this point.
So it doesn't just have to do with the guidelines. There's also other considerations that are taken.
So, you know, Don Bennett advocating vitamin D for some of his clients, it's not vegan, or other supplements.
Right.
Or, you know, somebody having, Dan McDonald having a higher fat content in his diet. Mm-hmm. I mean, Dan's going up and down more than some of the other pioneers in terms of what he's eaten at different times. I know he was eating really high fat for a short period of time after he'd been eating really low fat for a really long time. And then I know he moderated. And I've done the same thing too. And I've learned things from Dan. I know when Dan told me, you know, he felt a lot better after he started eating more fat, and I had been on like the 9-5-5 diet for a long time, I ate a lot of fat, and for about 3 months I did feel better eating a lot more fat. And then I didn't start feeling so good. So, you know, I think Dan McDonald's got an open mind about a lot of things.
And he's experimenting, like we all are.
Yeah. And he's also got to make a living, you know? I think supplements, there's a place for it for some people. Mm-hmm. And if you're not in that place where you don't need it, you know, it's not your place to just beat the hell out of somebody because they're not going through the same experiences as you. Mm-hmm. So,
I genuinely think that Dan recommends things that he's benefited from.
Yeah. And Dan's a nice guy. You know, I think Dan's not aggressive. Mm-hmm. Who can't get along with Dan McDonald? I don't agree with everything he says. I don't agree with everything I say sometimes. You know, we all change.
Yeah.
But we're all generally, the pioneers are on the same path.
Yeah. We all feel like we have the same, like, mission.
Yeah.
Yeah. So how do you feel when you see Harley and Freelee kind of showing off this different stuff that they're eating now?
You know, it's very interesting to me to see the progression of Harley and Freelee. First Harley pouring sugar on his smoothies, mm-hmm. and then doing some, like, you know, like, crazy videos eating 4 pizzas, to now, like, now they've got these, like, you know, they're showing their everyday everything. And it went from just eating cooked or processed foods once in a while to they're, like, they're hyped up about going out for Thai food. And they take these Instagram pictures of, like, I mean, it looks like every night they're going out to dinner and they're loving it.
Yeah.
They love it.
Most people love going out to eat.
And you know what I'm seeing? They went from being, you know, eating health first. They're cold stone back on food addiction. Mm-hmm. That's what it is. Mm-hmm. And they're that shit will spin you around, you know, and they're manipulating their own thinking into some crazy thing that this is okay and this is good. Thai food, going to Chinese restaurants, you know, they're not, there's oil in the pan. I've had steamed vegetables at a Chinese place.
Right.
It's not steamed vegetables. There's all kinds of residue in that pan. It doesn't taste like steamed vegetables at home.
Right. True.
Got a
little MSG in there.
Yeah, it's cold stone food addiction. Mm-hmm. And Harley and Freelee are back on being addicted to cooked and processed foods. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Okay.
That's where it's at.
So why do you think they made such a big change from being, like, super militant, hardcore, raw to just, like, promoting, as long as it's, you know, vegan carbohydrates, cooked food, you know, whatever. Why do you think they made that switch?
I think primarily because they saw so many people failing. And even though they were succeeding eating 100% raw, they felt like they were failing because their job every day was to promote and help people get on this lifestyle. Mm-hmm. So even though they were doing okay, everybody else was falling apart. And this was like the only option, you know? They wanted to see them more people become successful at eating better off the animal foods. But now I think they're back to being addicted to cooked and processed foods. And I think a lot of their, you know, followers are doing the same thing. And everybody's, like, trying to, you know, hear good things about their bad habits. But it's like, that food is going to just take you nowhere where you want to go.
Yeah, I totally understand that. okay, so I know there's been a few people in the past that Harley and Freelee have sort of, I guess, went after and singled out for different reasons, whether it was because they're promoting non-vegan products or whatever. And, you know, a lot of us used to think it was funny and they would make jokes about them. But, you know, now they're kind of going after our friends. And it's been personally difficult for me to watch. So, like, how do you feel when you see this happening?
You know, I think everybody can laugh at some of their quirky things sometimes. I think, you know, some of the videos that initially Harley puts out are almost kind of funny, and maybe the person he's making the video about doesn't appreciate it so much, but everybody, you know, it's lighthearted. But they, you know, I'm going to talk about Harley specifically because I've watched his videos. I don't really watch Freelee's videos. So from what I've seen with him going after, let's say, Doug Graham. Mm-hmm. I mean, Doug Graham has been doing this for 30 years, and, you know, I think he could have done a lot of other things in his life to make probably a lot more money. Mm-hmm. He's not a dumb guy at all. Yeah. And he's dedicated his life to trying to help people find a better way to live. And, I mean, I owe everything to Doug because, I mean, his book was just like, it's the Bible getting into this diet. And to see Harley go after him after Doug had done basically the same thing for him, I mean, 80-10-10, I know, had a huge impact on Harley. He promoted Absolutely. It like crazy. Mm-hmm. Doug's got a family. Doug's got a mortgage. Doug's got a daughter. You know, it's like, you got to show some restraint here. Mm-hmm. This is like common, just, you know, common sense. You just don't go after somebody like that. You know, he's gone way too far mm-hmm. with Doug. And and I've called him out on it, and I've got no influence on Harley. Nobody's got influence on Harley.
I know.
So it's been very painful for me to see him do that to Doug, especially after Doug's done so much for Harley. Mm-hmm. He had him come to all his events. He never charged him a penny. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, so he wants to find fault with some of the things that Doug does or says. I don't agree with everything Doug does or says, but I respect him. And I don't forget what he did for me. Mm-hmm. I don't ever want to forget where I came from.
Most of us wouldn't be eating this way if it wasn't for him.
Yeah, so to come after Doug is like inexcusable. Mm-hmm. Inexcusable. Awful. Not okay. I mean, I love Harley for what he did for me, but I lost so much respect for him for when he just continuously goes after these people. And then the next person he's been going after is Christina. I mean, it's like, here's a girl who wants to go and, like, give away fruits and vegetables to people and, like, you know, not make any money doing it. Mm-hmm. Her co-op's nonprofit. Right. She still lives at home. And so she can put all the revenue back into supporting her community and her co-op. You don't like her style? She's speaking to a different demographic, Harley. It's like, you know, her customers aren't going to be your customers, and that's okay, because there's different people in the world and everybody can relate to everybody differently. And right. Like, let her have her market and you have your market. Mm-hmm. Like, because she doesn't want to promote you. I mean, Harley doesn't promote me. I don't promote him. I'm not angry at him about it.
Right.
I think Christina's doing a fantastic job.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I'm speechless. I mean, how do you go after Christina? So she does this thing where she had somebody who was like really like riding on her coattails a little bit too much on promoting, you know, not promoting, but setting up their shots and stuff. I mean, listen, you know, if there's another runner out there who started running 100-mile races and talking about eating fruit, I could see how I could potentially become like a little bit uncomfortable with that. But that's not really the kind of person I am. I would be happy for that, because they're promoting the same goal as what I'm hoping for. Christina is essentially promoting what Harley wants.
Right.
I don't understand why he can't just let her have her market. Just, she's, go after like a McDonald's CEO, you know?
Exactly, yeah. It's like, it's a lot of wasted time for someone who's like, wants the same end result for people.
And then Dan McDonald, again, a different market. Some people do well taking supplements. Mm-hmm. whether they're placebo effects or whether the supplements really do help because they do have deficiencies, Dan speaks to a different demographic. Mm-hmm. He's got a huge audience. Dan's a good guy. Yeah. I mean, Dan McDonald was driving all over the country in an RV juicing like crazy. He wasn't making money doing this stuff.
Yeah, I remember those videos.
How do you, nobody is in this movement making money. I mean, real big money.
Right.
They're making a living.
Yeah.
How does Harley go after that? Dan, I mean, you don't want to buy supplements, don't buy them. But Dan's out there trying to get people to improve their life.
And so many people have changed their lives because of him.
Definitely. Yeah. So I think it's important to note that I believe the silent majority is not speaking up to Harley and Freelee because they're just too scared. Mm-hmm. And the Fruit Festival, although it took a pretty big hit from all this negativity, we're a viable, you know, enterprise. We're not going out of business. It's because the overwhelming majority of people don't support what Harley and Freelee are doing, but they're just too scared to say anything because they don't want to be the next person to get beat up. So I think it's terrible that they're going after people. They should be focused on going after, if they're going to go after anybody, they should go after people that deserve it, like Monsanto or these huge, you know, multinational food companies that just totally destroy the earth and make horrible foods.
Right.
I mean, how you waste your time going after Christina? Mm-hmm. Happy, nice Christina?
So why do you think it is that they haven't gone after you? I mean, they sort of have with the Fruit Festival, but, you know.
Oh, they've gone after me. They haven't gone after me, like, directly,
right.
But as far as I'm concerned, they've gone after me big time.
Yeah.
I mean, the Fruit Festival took a huge hit. They continuously are making references that are negative and they're,
calling
you know.
Calling us elitists.
Yeah, and it's constantly, you know, it's like, hey, you want to promote your festival for all till four? I mean, it could have gone a totally different way. They could have been like, you know what? We've got a different demographic. We're going to create our event. Let's support each other.
Yeah, because I am totally in support of the Raw Till 4. Like, if that's what works for some people and that's what gets people eating more fruit and being vegan, that's great.
Polarizing the whole thing is just awful. It's a lose-lose. And it goes back to kind of like how I feel like Harley just had this really rough time. And he feel like he was betrayed by the people at the Fruit Festival. He feels like he's been betrayed by me. And it's like, nah, man, we're trying to maintain an ethos and a mission from which, you know, we originated from. We don't want to stray and kind of like bend to the marketplace. We want to maintain, you know, our core values. Whether, even if we don't get more views on our videos, we don't make more money on YouTube, even if the festival stays smaller than it could get, if we did change things, no. We're principled.
Right. So why do you think that they keep focusing on this? Why do they keep attacking these people and the festival just over and over?
They feel betrayed and they're angry. They're really angry. And I understand that anger. It didn't have to go this way. God knows I tried hard as hell. I offered to fly to Australia. Mm-hmm. I offered to fly them here to Hawaii because I knew that if we could have face-to-face, and not have just the internet, which is just totally emotionless,
right.
That way we could work something out. But they, you know, they just didn't want to do it.
Okay. Well, I think it's a shame. I think we're all sad to see them go. And I think the intention was always for them to stay pioneers, right?
So. Yeah.
Well, so what do you think? Do you have anything else you want to add? Or?
Well, I'd like people to support the Fruit Festival.
Okay.
You know, Harley and Freelee and a lot of their fans who have been manipulated by things that are not true or exaggerated or taken out of context, I think they should reconsider what the festival's about.
Mm-hmm.
And if people don't support the Fruit Festival, you know what? It will go away. It will. I mean, and I'll just have to accept that. It's 2 weeks this year. It was a huge thing for me to sign on for the liability, and I'm just going to struggle like hell to make ends meet. I'm going to have to bail out the event again this year, which I'm not happy about. And it'll put a lot of stress on me, which I don't appreciate. And that stress didn't have to come if Harley and Freelee, I thought, could have been a lot more mature about the situation. So anybody who's watching this video, I'd like you to please come to the Fruit Festival. And
so why should they come? Other than just, you know, supporting the movement, like, what are they going to get out of it?
Well, I think, one, they'll have a great time. I mean, I really believe that overwhelming majority of people that come to the festival really enjoy themselves.
Absolutely, yeah.
It's a great, great place. It's a real community now because we get so many people that come back year after year. And they just give it a shot. We need this. And it's a demonstration. I've said it so many times. It's not just a good time. We're sending a message. Mm-hmm. And we're going to get some major networks to do documentaries on the festival. We're going to get a stronger voice. Mm-hmm. We got to do it together. So if you sign up and you pay, because we need people to pay, fruits and vegetables are expensive. Mm-hmm. We're gonna create a huge message, and it's gonna reach people, and we're gonna change the world. We're gonna do it.
I've gotta say, like, I've attended the first festival, and I've been to every single festival, and I will be at every festival that I can possibly be at. And it has changed and grown so much from the first one. Like, it was like, what was it, like 200 people or something the first one? Then it was like 400, and then it was 650, and then this year it'll probably be even more. So it's like, it's growing. You know, the community is there, and you gotta be a part of it. You gotta participate.
Yep. So, sorry, I was got a little excited. I'm just, watching all this stuff go on for months and months and months and not make any videos. It was frustrating, but I felt like I needed to just let it take its course. And I feel like it's died down now. I'm saying my piece. Yeah. I'm not going to keep making videos. I'm not going to respond to emails. I don't live on YouTube. I work. Yeah. I don't have time to do this stuff. I hope people accept what my side of the story is. And I guess I'll find out if people believe in the vision of what the festival is about. Come August 17th, see how many people show up.
Yep. Well, I'm excited for the festival, and I'm excited to see this community grow, and I appreciate you taking the time and doing this, and I'm sure people are really happy to, you know, hear you speak out now. So.
Oh, thanks for doing the interview.